Jackson Isabire Bazare embarked on his agricultural journey by starting with a small number of plants on a compact piece of land. By nurturing a modest collection of mango trees, he achieved a substantial income. Encouraged by his accomplishment, he set his sights on expanding the farm ambitiously to cover an entire acre, which he named Kilinzo Farm. Kilinzo Farm functions as a versatile agricultural enterprise, cultivating both soursop and mangoes. Notably, mango cultivation makes up a significant proportion, occupying 85% of the total land area. Kilinzo Farm is situated in Nabitovu Village, Ivukura Sub-County, Namutumba District, Bukono Constituency. However, what motivated Isabir, a holder of a social science degree, to delve into the realm of mango farming?
With farming, it's I think inborn, or I just love it. Because I grew up seeing farming, participating in farming. So even after university, I felt among the things that I can do alongside the professional jobs that I do, I have to do farming. And of recent, I've learned that farming is a real business. If you really go there and you want to make money, you can easily make money. You can easily make your life better through farming. That's why each day I feel like promoting mango farming to higher levels.
Starting a farm is consistently challenging due to the initial requirements, but the primary focal point pertains to the matter of capital, a hurdle that has deterred numerous aspiring individuals from embarking on their agricultural journeys. Drawing from Isabire's expertise in mango farming, he offers guidance on effectively navigating the capital obstacle when initiating and managing your mango farm to ensure profitability.
It starts with the mindset, because I'm trying to now educate people that starting something doesn't require to have millions of money. I've always been encouraging people to start even farming. Those who are even in a plot of fitted by 100, where you put your house, I'm encouraging people to put some plants along at the boundary. These plants, it can always provide food, mangoes for your family. Then the man that you would spend going to the market to buy fruits, you will save it. Second, that the way how we produce, the way how we care for these mangoes. If you have like five plants of them, those five plants are enough for you to eat in your home and even to sell some of them. So that will be the beginning of your income. When we thought of starting Kilinzo Farm, we did not acquire land before starting this farm. The little demand that we've been getting, saving from each season, is the demand that we are using to add on the land. Because remember, I told you that we started with 1 acre, but at least each season that goes, we are able to save some money. And from that money, we ask the neighbors to add us some land, because we feel like this farm has to expand. As I told you, this farm is at now 15 acres, but our dream is to expand this farm up to 100 acres. And God with us, and we shall achieve it.
The introduction of Tommy Atkins mangoes brought about a transformative shift in Isabire's life and that of his family. Initially cultivating a single acre, the realization that each mango could fetch a price of 3,000 shillings prompted him to progressively expand his farm. Presently, he possesses 15 acres of land dedicated to mango cultivation, with aspirations to further extend his holdings to a sprawling 1,000 acres in the times ahead.
In the first place, I started with a type of mango, which is called Tommy. Tommy, this is in the purplish color when it gets ready, and it's much attractive when it reaches the market. This Tommy you see, it grows in a bigger size, that when you take it to the market, it can fetch you some good money, and it's sweet. Even when it's raw. So when we had that 1 acre of Tommy, we went to the market and we saw how it was. earning us some good money. I would take like some few mangoes in the boxes and get like 300,000 shillings. They said, wow, how much can, what else can you do to earn this? What if we are having like, what if we are able to take like 10 boxes? So the best way is to expand the farm to 2 to 3 acres. So this Tommy is more, I think it's much, much better that even people can eat when it's raw. So people can easily buy whether it's ripe or not. And as we keep on moving with this in this project, we realize that there is need also to think about other species for different reasons. There are some species which someone can't eat when they are raw in the farm. They are sour, bitter. They are only sweet when they get ripe. So the people would really disturb you eating when they are raw. They always leave them and you get money when they get it ready. There are some species which take longer to mature. That you can harvest them when other mangoes are out of season. So the more when you produce mangoes from your farm when there's a bit of scarcity, always they'll be a very good price. Like when in a season where mangoes are too much in the market, they can buy this mango at 1,000. But at the time when there's a scarcity, this mango had got 3,000, 4,000. So while you sold 4 mangoes to get 4,000, you only sell 1 piece to get 4,000. So we kept on discovering, doing more research from the farm to get to know the species which take long to get mature, those which can come out of season, those which are easy to control from people who disturb them when they are growing, and the rot. And as I speak right now, we have about 7 species in the farm. We have this Tommy as the first one. This is called the apple mango. To most of the people know that apple comes from Kenya, but we've discovered from Kizo Farm that apple mangoes can do even much better here in Uganda, here in Busoga. So it's one of the species that we have at the farm. Then we have also the one called the palvin. Palvin is so good that when it comes to giving us fruits, it gives us more. From one plant, you can even have more than 200 pieces, 300 pieces. And it's also almost similar to Tommy because it gives a very good color. Those are 3 species. Then we have also the one called the Kent. Kent is too huge and remains in its greenish, but it almost puts on weight like the way you see this. The way you see this, Tommy. This is the Kent. You see, it's almost the same with the Tommy in the size, but for it remains in the green even when it's ripe. We have those are the 4 species. Then we have Zlat. Then we have Zlat. We've seen somewhere in the farm Zlat. We've seen somewhere this Zlat. Zlat is very good. It goes even at one and a quarter or 1.5 kilo. When you were one time in the exhibition, I was thinking, which kind of mango? Where does it come from? People didn't know that it comes from Busoga here. It's also very good. It features some good money. Those are the 5. Those are 5 species. Then we have Kaiti. As we move around, we shall see also Kaiti. Kaiti is good. It's reddish in color. It's also at times so huge, and it takes long to mature in the farm. That's the type that comes after we have harvested most of the types. And by the time it gets ready, it reaches the market. When the businessmen, the consumers, are really lacking mangoes. They feel like if we get 1 piece, they can even get better at 10,000. So that is the Kaiti. Then the 7th, we have Bire. Bire is the first one to get mature in the farm. That's why you're not seeing it that now. The first week, it's the first one to start harvesting. And when it gets ready, the whole tree will get ripe and you harvest at once. So those are the 7 species we have in the farm.
Isabiria provides guidance to mango farmers on optimizing profit generation from their farms by advising them on the ideal number of trees that can be accommodated per acre.
In an acre, we put 300 plants, but always the spacing matters. Like the way you see, we planted this with a smaller space, but we keep on now reducing. We do the thinning always and the pruning. So that when you have an acre, you can congest them, harvest for the 4 years. When the branches keep on meeting each other, expanding, you prune. When you see that the pruning does not really help you, then you start thinning, removing other plants. So for us at Kirizo, we can even congest them can even put 300 feet in an acre. Knowing that we can harvest from them in the first 4 years, then we keep on removing. That would be a loss, because if a tree is giving you 100,000 per acre and you're harvesting twice in a year, times 4 years, those are the 8 seasons. So if each tree is giving you 100,000 or 200,000, it keeps on increasing. That would be some good money for the 4 years. So even if you remove the tree and leave others to get the space, it would be a very big loss. So on average, you can put 300 feet. If those who don't wish to get disturbed in removing and so on, they can even put 200 feet. So you give them enough space.
We attempted to determine whether the mentioned area has the capacity to support various varieties of mango trees when cultivated within the garden, aiming to maximize profitability from your mango farm.
When you are planting and you feel you want to give enough space, you can give 17 feet by 17 feet. From the plant, you give 17. In the line, you give 17. That one won't disturb you the moving all the time, within the harvesting. But if you feel like you have time to remove some plants with time, you can make 15 by 15. 10 by 15, yes. You can harvest for some years, then after that you remove. It won't be a very big loss at all. And first we love that. Because there's no need for us to leave the space, because these trees will meet each other in the next 4 years. Why? Better if you harvest in the first 4 years, then you give them enough space. We realize there is no bigger difference, because these mangoes of ours, all of them start giving you fruits when they are quite young. Very, very short. That even a baby of 2 years can pick some mangoes. You see, a tree like this one, we've harvested from this tree for about 5 to 6 years. But you see how it is. Yeah? Even a baby of 2 years to 3 years can pick a mango and eat. So there's no big worry when you are planting. They're almost the same. I think when you move around the farm, even a baby who doesn't even stand, can even move and go under the tree and pick a mango. You can see the other side where the apple is. So these mangoes are well improved. They put on in a very short time when they are very short. So they don't need much space when they are in the first years of the harvest.
Successful large-scale harvesting begins with the initial cultivation approach of your crops right from the onset. When it comes to mango trees, Isabiria offers valuable instructions on the correct methods for planting and nurturing your trees, ensuring a bumper harvest when the time comes to reap the rewards.
When we are planting, there's nothing much complicated when you're planting, because even digging the hole where I put the tree, it's just 2 feet by 2 feet. You make wide 2 feet and deep 2 feet. And when you have some manure, organic manure, you try to mix in the soil when you're planting. But if the soil is very good, like ours here, we don't put much manure when you're planting. And that's the truth about the most of the soil in Uganda. We are lucky to have a very fertile land. I think in Africa, there's no need, much need for applying manure everywhere. And these mangoes, this is why I've liked them so much. They are much resistant to each and every condition. They are one of the fruits which can survive in any kind of condition. Whether drought, they are so resistant to any weather changes. They are so resistant to pesticides, to pests which affect them. So planting is very simple and it's not so much complicated. So after planting, what you need to always take care of, because these are grafted mangoes. They graft them with another species of mango. Normally we graft them with the indigenous plants. So when you plant, it picks and brings the flowers. You need always to check in the garden to see that there are no some branches coming from the indigenous one. Because if you delay, it will kill this one grafted with. Then at the end of the day, you blame someone who sold to you the seedling, that he sold to you the indigenous species, but because it was your delay. Those are some of the tips that we take through the farmers which want to join the mango farming. Very simple. And even spraying, because right now almost everything that you do, you need to fight pests. Because we wonder why the pests are so much these days. Because we no longer have forests where they used to hide. So any plant that you put there is their only food, is their only hideout, they always attack them. So you try to kill them to apply something that can affect, that can make these plants grow well, at least once in a month. Then in a short period of 2.5 years to 3 years, you start seeing some good mangoes coming.
Caring for your mango trees follows the same principles as tending to other fruit-bearing trees. It is important to water the trees deeply so that the extensive taproot gets properly soaked. Allow the upper layer of the soil to become dry to a depth of a few inches before watering the trees once more. During the 2 months leading up to flowering, it is recommended to abstain from irrigation. Afterwards, once the fruit starts forming, you can resume the watering process. Isabire provides expert guidance on effectively managing your mango farm to ensure a bountiful harvest.
A mango is a mango, just as I've said. Mango is a mango. There's no species which requires much care compared to the other. You give them equally same care. If it's checking to avoid the indigenous one to shoot up, the same. If it is spraying to avoid to fight the fungal diseases, it's the same. If it's spraying to fight the pests which affect them, the same. There's no special care basing on the species. And what I want to tell you is that caring for mangoes is the most easiest thing that you can do, even when you're employed somewhere very far. You come once in a month, you look at your plants, you apply something, then you go back, come after a month. Only that when maybe they start flowering, that's when maybe you can try to come twice in a month, and you wait for the time of harvesting.
When should the farmer commence the pruning of their mango trees, and what is the significance of conducting this activity?
Pruning, we do always pruning because these mangoes require direct sun, direct light. Because when you don't have enough light, it will affect the flowers. You have to follow down. Because when the flowers are there, they need this light or the sunshine. It aids this process of the what? Or the pollination and so on. And we need this light because when these mangoes don't fail to get enough sunlight, they don't change. You see, this is Tome. It's the same type of this. The only difference is that this one got enough sun. light. This one didn't what get. And when you go to, when you take the market, this one would be much attractive to the buyer. This one will, someone will think, no, this is not Tommy. I think this is Kent. So if some, if a farmer, if a consumer is much interested in Tommy, it will take you much time to convince him that this is Tommy. So we need this direct light in the farm because it supports the flowering. Some mango, some farmers always complain, I have my mango plants, but since I planted them, they never put on mangoes. And always it's a problem of not pruning, because each flower that comes, it requires the sunlight. So actually, the process takes place of within these flowers to build this, to bring these small mangoes, and the mangoes keep on growing. So that's why we need to do often the pruning. You don't need to have a thick forest within the mango farm.
Becoming a mango farmer might be more challenging than it sounds, considering the patience required to wait until the first harvest from your mango trees. It is advisable to familiarize yourself with the difficulties of mango farming before diving into it, and Isabri offers insights into primary challenges encountered in the field of mango cultivation.
Where there are good things, there is at least some bad things alongside the good things. The challenges are not many. That's why I'm not talking about many challenges, but still we have the challenge in the people who produce the pesticides. Because normally the quality changes. We actually need people who produce quality pesticides, which can really fight some stronger pesticides which affect these mangoes. And quality assurance, I think, is much required in that area. Normally, when we go there to buy, we just buy, you can't know. But you realize that you applied something but didn't work well, and you really see from the products that you produce. And once you produce the product which is not good, it will affect the market so much. So that's one of the challenges.
Isabria provides us with an illustration of the expenses incurred for each tree until the point of mango harvesting.
On average, I think less than 50,000 in a period of 2 years and a half. Because as I told you, you don't need to spray every day, once in a month. And a month, it has 12 months. And you realize that some of the things that you apply is only 1 ml, mixing 1 ml of water, 1 liter of water. So you, when you buy something that you are applying on the leaves and so on, less than 50,000 is just enough till the time of harvesting. And that's just why I say that the what you invest in is much less compared to what you get out of the farm. There's no what you call much care and complicated care that you have to apply when you are caring for the mangoes. Okay, it's the only type of farming or crop that you have to engage in and you don't invest in much as compared to other things.
In the upcoming episode, Isabria will guide us in exploring the location and pricing of mangoes in the market. This possesses a significant challenge for our farmers, and he will share his strategies for addressing this issue over time. This concludes today's Harvest Money segment, and I would like to bid farewell. Until next week, goodbye.